Many moons ago, when I was studying history at ODU as a student, I had an internship with the Norfolk Historical Society, and I interned with Peggy McPhillips. You know, it's always nice to be able to share a stage with you, I appreciate the opportunity. So, as Peggy said, my name is Josh, and today we're going to talk about the art and architecture of Elmwood Cemetery. So, a few things. Well, first let's talk about what makes Elmwood so special. So, first of all, it's pretty old. It's celebrating its 170th anniversary this year. It's designed in what is known as Victorian Rural Park Cemetery design, which is essentially a combination of land uses, cemetery, a burial ground, and also a park, a recreational space. So this idea came out of Europe decades prior, during increased industrialization, where cities were looking for opportunities for their residents to get out of the cities and find some respite. So they decided to combine the cemeteries, which were being run by cities for sanitary purposes at that time anyway, and parks. And so you get these Victorian era parks that are very lush, very park-like, and are really built for the living as well as the dead. 1853 and prior, the idea of the large-scale museum system is still in its infancy, and so there aren't quite as many opportunities for artists in that sense to have their arts purchased by large organizations en masse and put on display. One area that allowed for artists to make good commissions was cemeteries. This was a place where the grieving, vulnerable as they were would go out of their way to pay for a large monument to honor their loved one, or pay for a large monument to show how religious they were, or pay for a large monument to show how much money they had. So what we have is a rich collection of artwork, which is the basis of today's chat. And with that, in Elmwood itself, we have dozens of artists, different types of architecture, both neoclassical and neo-Gothic architecture, as I mentioned before, a unique recreational space. So at one point, I became briefly obsessed with finding the oldest image of Elmwood that I could find. And this was the one that I could find, 1904. So who here has been to Elmwood? Okay, so most people, all right. Can't lie to you. So this is an image of Elmwood, which you see in the background, and it is taken from the vantage point of Cedar Grove Cemetery. So as you know today, they are both separated by Princess Anne Road, which at one point was a creek, essentially. If you know where The Hague is today, that used to extend far past the Chrysler Museum and wander up and peter out about a quarter mile away from where this picture was taken. So what we see here is the marshy kind of creek bed where Princess Anne Road would normally go, and a bridge that connected Elmwood with Cedar Grove. And as you can see even here, it's a very aesthetically pleasing recreational space meant to attract people to visit it. This is another old photo from the 1910s, and you can see how lush the cemetery was at the time. It is called Elmwood because of, at one point, the abundance of elm trees that were there. But unfortunately, due to a pestilence that took over elm trees some time ago, a lot of elm trees in Elmwood died. There isn't quite as well-defined tree tunnel here in this picture now, but still pretty lush. And pay attention to this guy on the side, this mausoleum, because he might be important later. We call that foreshadowing. So here's just another pleasant image, scene of Elmwood. And as I was saying before, it is a unique recreational space. So this is an image from the 1940s of a celebration of Memorial Day. So this was a ceremony, series of speeches, and then a picnic within the grounds of Elmwood. This is a group of people running the From Here to Eternity 5K in through Elmwood, which is put on by the Norfolk Society for Cemetery Conservation every year to raise money for the cemeteries. This poor lady, I feel bad. She was just trying to run a 5K. She did not know she was going to be put on a screen 10 feet tall in 7 years later, but here she is. And then this guy, back when I used to give tours of Elmwood Cemetery, so walking tours as well. So we have walking tours. The Cemetery Conservation Group always also has a photography contest that they hold every year, 5Ks, picnics, so a recreational space, a park, if you will. So I wanted to mention kind of the intention, uses intended for Elmwood, so that we had a little context as we moved farther in. So what we're really here to talk about is the artwork. So what kind of artwork is in Elmwood? Well, there's a lot of different types. As you can see, there's a lot of industrial metallurgy. There's sculpture, molding, etc. There's some really great examples of statuary, as well as stone mosaics, and there's a few works of stained glass as well. So when I used to give tours of Elmwood Cemetery, I always used to start at the Rosina Veith tomb. For a lot of reasons, there's a lot of symbolism all in one place, and it kind of helped me set the tone for the tour. There's a covered urn up here, and there's some ivy here, but I'm not really here to talk about the symbolism. I really want to talk about this tableau right in the middle. So this is Rosina Veith's tomb, 1877, and this is a painting of Daniel Huntington called Mercy's Dream, 19 years earlier. So art imitating art, right? Picasso said, good artists borrow, great artists steal, right? So whoever did this tableau knew that before Picasso. Let's look at these a little more. We can see here there's two figures. There's a woman and then there's presumably an angel. Now the woman that is kneeling next to the tree here, let me go back here. She is leaning next to a tree, and she represents the deceased. She represents the person that is buried below. Now how do we know that? Well, there's a few telltale signs. One is this very sad-looking tree behind her, which is not only kind of bent over as if sobbing itself, but it also lacks any branches, any trees. It is a tree of life, but it has been cut short. So with the tree of life having been cut short, it represents death. And this lady leaning up against that tree means that this lady is dead. That's basically how we kind of put two and two together. So this lady is dead, and this angel is approaching to place a crown, a cross and a crown, on her, signifying that she was virtuous, that she's going to make it to heaven. And then in the with the angel's left hand, she at one point was pointing the way to heaven, guiding the way to heaven. Now, time has not been fortunate to her hand, so now she is nubbing her way to heaven. But she's going to get to heaven either way. It doesn't matter. You know, God is not that picky. It's one finger, two fingers, doesn't matter. So the point is, this angel is guiding the deceased through the afterlife to heaven. And as you can see here, it's the exact same thing. In fact, let me move forward here. We can see them side by side, right? So as you can see, the woman is in the exact same pose. The hand is in the exact same position. This hand is in the exact same position. Everything is essentially the same. And over here, you know, of course, this lady actually has her fingers. So what we have here is, first of all, the ability to copy a work of art before copyright laws really existed. There really weren't any back then. And this is also, so I don't know if I mentioned, but Mercy's Dream is in the National Gallery. It's in the American Art, the Smithsonian American Art Museum. So pretty well-known painting itself. And it took me giving a tour of Elmwood with an art curator in the crowd for me to realize that these two were related. So just one more shot of that tableau there, but this is an example of art imitating other art. So moving on to our next piece, most people who have been in Elmwood or even driven by are familiar with this statue, known as the Cooper Angel. This was created by sculptor William Cooper, a Norfolk native, for his mother, Euphemia Cooper, upon her death in 1895. So, little detail here. This is a 16-foot tall installation. So the statue itself is 8 feet tall, while the base is about 6 feet tall. So altogether, it is towering. It's very possibly, it's definitely one of the tallest and largest statues in Elmwood. And one thing that I've always appreciated about not just this statue, but statuary in general is an artist's ability to use molten metal to depict the softest of materials. So here, let's just take a look at what is being depicted here. We have an angel with wings. So the wings are presumably light, feathery, soft. We have the angel's dress, the folds of the angel's dress here. We also have the, We also have the angel's face, of course, and their hair, and their skin, all soft. And of course, this large parchment, which brings me to my next point, is that this is the second angel of three that we're going to talk about today. I swear it's not all angel art, I promise, but it starts off strong, right? So we had the guiding angel pointing the way to heaven. Sometimes you'll see them putting flower petals on the ground, leading a pathway to heaven. Now we have what's known as a recording angel. Recording angels usually are either writing, recording someone's name in the Book of Life, or they already have something written down for them on parchment or a book and they're simply reading it. So that is angel number two. The third angel, you're just gonna have to wait for that. That's called a cliffhanger. So again, William Cooper was a renowned sculptor, and we're gonna talk more about him later on. So. I just wanted to focus on the Cooper Angel for now. So we're going to go to another angel, a smaller one. And this is part of Christopher Columbus and Elizabeth Benson's grave. So C.C. Benson, do you think his parents had big hopes for him? Christopher Columbus Benson, I mean, what was there to discover at that point? Anyway, so this is actually mother and son. I won't go into the story of them because we're going to focus on the artwork. But this is C.C. Benson and Elizabeth Benson. So the angel that we have here is the third angel. It's known as a mourning angel. And as you can guess, they are typically seen either praying or crying with their face in their hands. So you have the guiding angel, recording angel, and the mourning angel. Now, the difference between this angel and the one that we just saw, the Cooper angel, there's a lot of differences, but the main one is that the Cooper Angel, there was one made, and it was for a specific person. It was made by William Cooper for his mother, Euphemia, upon her death. Whereas the Benson grave here is essentially it was a mass production. There's hundreds of these. It was made by a company. It was sold through the Sears Roebuck catalog, and they're all up and down the East Coast. So. It looks, it's still a work of art in and of itself, right? And we're gonna talk a little bit about what it's made of and kind of its general construction. So the Benson angel and those like it were made out of white bronze. So does anyone in here own anything that is white bronze? Has anyone in here heard of white bronze? All right, Well, that's because white bronze isn't real, right? White bronze is a fake term for zinc. So yeah, it's just a marketing term for zinc, or at least it used to be. Basically, the Benson Angel and others like it made out of zinc, and they found that when they described it as a zinc alloy or a zinc statue, people didn't know what zinc was. It started with a Z, and it had a foreign sound, and they didn't like it, right? So they decided that they would call it white bronze because everyone knew bronze. Everyone knows bronze, and that was associated with longevity, et cetera. So they started calling it white bronze, and all of a sudden, people started buying it, right? So it's just a great example of marketing and old switcheroo, but it's made out of white bronze, right? So it's also hollow, which makes it for an interesting story because, as you can probably see, I'm gonna rewind this for a second just so that we can look at it. But if you see here, it has the appearance, especially from afar, of rock, of stone. But when you get up close to it and you tap on it, it is hollow and it rings like a empty piece of metal. So what smugglers realized, because they're very clever, they realized that they could stuff it full of liquor during Prohibition and that they could move it and that law enforcement would look at it from afar and assume that it was solid stone and that it was going to a memorial and these must be upstanding chaps trying to honor the dead and we're just going to pass them right through. So it was a very effective way of smuggling, and because it was used to smuggle liquor, you know, it's one of my favorites. So this was also an early form of customization. So this was a customized monument, which is another marketing term that they used at the time. So you've probably heard of the like houses that you can buy, and every single house, or most of them in the neighborhood, they all look the same, but you get to pick your own doorknob and your own carpet and your own mirror in the bathroom, and they call it a custom house, right? It's customized. That's essentially what we're talking about here. Each one was not different. The template was the same for all of these. So what was different, so the angel on all, you know, the several hundred that were sold of these, and the base, all the same. What was customizable was the nameplate, of course, as well as the four symbols that you could put on the side here. So they chose lilies, wheat, handshake, and what looks like ivy, right? And I think they had about a dozen different symbols that you could choose from. And then, so you have your own mix of symbols and your own nameplate, and now it's a customized monument, right? So a little bit of early marketing, if you will. But I gotta go through this again. But still. A work of art nonetheless. Oh, I see what I did here. There we go. So now we're moving on to some other statues that aren't angels. I know you're all relieved, right? So this is the statues that flank the entrance to the core mausoleum. So these patinaed folks right in front. So we're gonna ignore the mausoleum itself for the time being, even though it is quite impressive. So we're going to talk about these two guys right here in front. So these are titled in pairs, Love and Faith, and Hope and Charity. So these are actually done, these were created by an artist named Edward Field Sanford Jr. He was part of a style that was popular for like a decade in the early 20th century known as Modern Archaic. Which is essentially, it's kind of what it sounds like. It was a combination of modern techniques and materials, and it was mixed with anything that had to do with ancient Greece, ancient Rome, or ancient Egypt. So you could have a mixture of all of those things. Nothing had to be classically accurate, as you'll see in when we break down all of these here. So it was a specific type of statuary kind of style. Sanford has many artistic credits nationwide in museums and public parks, and the statues here are his only works there in Elmwood. So we have a nice shot of them there. So Right there, there's some damage on top of the sphere there, and we're gonna come back to that in a few. So I just wanted to click through these and let everyone kind of take them in for a moment. I am the founder of Norfolk Tour Company, and I run that, but Norfolk Tour Company does not give tours of Elmwood. I used to give tours of Elmwood personally, but Norfolk Society for Cemetery Conservation is the only group that gives tours of Norfolk's public cemeteries. And for good reason, they raise money for the cemeteries, so they're the only ones that give them. The reason I mention this is because when I did give the tours, I did a lot of research on these cemeteries, and probably my favorite find in the 5 years that I gave tours for them was the following. So while I was researching these sculptures or statues, I found out that these statues were originally in a gallery in New York for several years, and they were in several traveling exhibitions. So these were actual, you know, museum quality, if you will. Someone thought they were. Museum quality statues. And not only were they museum quality and not only were they in exhibits, but they were also reviewed. So this is from the International Studio Review, and this is an article specifically on Edward Field Sanford and his Love and Faith, Hope and Charity statues. And as you can see right there, Corps Mausoleum, Norfolk, Virginia, bada bing. So I was really excited when I found this, especially because as part of this review, they had these great images of the statues right after they were installed. So they've changed a little bit over the years. Of course, they're nice and patinaed now. They have that that light green rust all over them. But this is what they look like brand new. They were nice and dark brown. And what's more, you can see what was missing in that photo from a few minutes ago. So I'm gonna leave that there, and you'll find out what it is in just a moment. Because what I'd like to do now, if you'll indulge me, is this will take about 1 minute. I want to read part of the review, the artistic review of these. Let me get rid of that. I want to read part of this review. I think you'll appreciate it. So this is written by the author of the review that we just saw. So it starts with love and faith, right? So the one's on the right. Love kneels by the side of faith, the two entwined by the same piece of drapery. Around her head are ivy leaves, and in her hand she holds the dove of Venus. Faith is seated and wears an elaborately designed headdress surmounted by a winged sphinx. In her hands she holds the world upon which Zeus is standing, fantastically carved with ships and animals. In the second group are Love and Faith's inseparable companions, Hope and Charity, on our left. Charity is seated, a cornucopia resting against her arm, as you can see on the far left. This detail is beautifully executed. Around the top, a delicate relief of figures, symbolic of charity, the delicate fluted stem ending in a conventional lion's head. The brow of Charity is surmounted by an ibis, with the sweeping wings and tail covering her head and neck. Hope, which is a nude figure strongly indicative of Egyptian influences, kneels closely pressed against the side of Charity. Around her head is a simple flag from which fall curiously twining locks. In her outstretched hand, she holds Pandora's box. These two groups are so designed that with the door of the mausoleum, they all unite into a single mass. The figures are finished with the most elaborate and ingenious ornamentation. So that is, those are the words of the art critic, essentially. I thought it was a great description of these. And it also lends insight into what was missing in that last photo. So that is a small sphere which represents the world, and that is a small, about 18-inch statue of Zeus standing upon the world, who unfortunately some rascal vandalized, and it's no longer there. But you can see what it looked like when it was originally installed. So we've talked a little bit about the art of Elmwood, and now we're going to talk a little bit about the artists, some of the artists that are buried in Elmwood. There are three big ones. We have Benjamin Adworth Richardson, we have William Cooper, who we've briefly mentioned earlier, and then we have Susan Watkins. So all three of these all three of these artists were accomplished in their time. I say that because sometimes artists are dirt poor until they die, and then all of a sudden their art is worth something and people recognize them. And that happens sometimes. But all three of these artists made their living making art. And Susan Watkins, they were all accomplished. Susan Watkins was acclaimed, and we'll talk more about that more. She was an awarded, highly regarded painter. Oh, of course, they're all buried here. So we're going to talk briefly about Richardson and some of his paintings and spend a little more time on the other two. So Benjamin Richardson really liked the Civil War, and he painted a lot of paintings about it, specifically the naval battles of the Civil War and kind of the dramas of the Monitor and the Merrimack and a lot of local scenes. So this is, you can see Fort Norfolk there in the background. Or actually, I believe that's Portsmouth, and this is actually taken from the vantage point of Fort Norfolk. As you can see, I'm not going to read the captions. You can read those yourselves. All of these paintings of Richardson's are owned by the Chrysler. So all of the artwork of Richardson and Watkins that we'll talk about later, they're all these are all Chrysler Museum images. Ending on a high note here with Richardson's paintings of the Civil War. So we breezed through that a little bit because I wanted to talk a little bit longer about Susan Watkins, who is my favorite. So Susan Watkins died before, she died too soon. She was only 38 when she died. She was a renowned French Impressionist painter and a renowned American Impressionist painter. I say that because she was born in America and she died in America, but she spent over a decade in Paris learning, and she also exhibited worldwide. So she was very much, in fact, if you go to the Chrysler Museum, Susan Watkins' paintings are in the French Impressionist Gallery and in the American Impressionist Gallery, because they really couldn't pick because she produced works in both countries. So Susan Watkins had an agent, and his name was, I'm not making this up, Goldsboro Serpell. Tell me that's not the name of like a villain in a story. Is there anybody from the Serpell family here? Great. it's an interesting name. That's all really. But he was her agent. He kind of helped with the logistics of finding exhibits for her and things like that. He asked her to marry him several times. And she said no, basically because she didn't need the money. She didn't need to be tied down. She didn't need to be somebody's wife. She was an artist. While she was in Paris, she got sick, and she found out it was tuberculosis and it had progressed, and it was not looking very good. So it was then that she decided to say, I do. And so she married him, and they moved back to Norfolk. Unfortunately, a few months later, she died. Her husband, as you can see here, left the rest of her works, some of which are unfinished. Some of which are finished, to the Norfolk Museum of Arts and Sciences, which is now called the Chrysler Museum of Art. So these are a few of the paintings done by Susan Watkins in Paris, the Garden of Luxembourg. Her ability to depict light as it kind of rakes across the body or across fabric or across a wall is really one of her hallmarks. This particular painting, the 1830s girl, won her several medals at large expositions and salons is typically on display in the Chrysler Museum. So 1830s girl, let's see. It won a third class gold medal at the Paris Salon. 1901, which was, she was the first American to ever place in the paintings category for the Paris Salon. So a nice distinction. Later on, she won at the Universal Exposition in St. Louis. It was a silver medal for that painting. And then she, for a different painting, she won a large cash prize at an exhibition for the National Academy of Design. So I mention all of this because, as I mentioned, all of these artists made their living making artwork, but Susan Watkins was acclaimed and awarded. And also, not just by academia, but by her peers. Her mentor was William Merritt Chase. If anybody is familiar, William Merritt Chase was really the head of the American Impressionist movement really the main kind of drive behind that. So, and he highly respected her, and we'll come back to that in a moment. So a couple more of Susan Watkins' paintings. So this is Lady in Yellow. One thing that I like is about Susan Watkins' paintings is not only her play with bright direct light kind of shining on bodies or walls and kind of that that depiction of kind of a snapshot in time, but also her experimentation with the interplay between light and fabric and darkness and how to make them all blend together. So this is titled Lady in Yellow. And again, we aren't 100% sure who this person is. We think that it was her sister-in-law, but the reason that we don't really know who it is because the portraiture is not important. What was important was the play, the interplay between light and fabric and color, at least according to Susan Watkins. So if you look here, you'll see that the window frame, the pillows, the wall, the couch, the rug, they're all a very similar dim, burnt red, kind of darkish, faded color. And yet they're all distinct. We can tell that if we were in this room, it would be kind of dim. This is a dim scene. And yet, in the center, everything is kind of rotating around this bright yellow dress. And even though it's dim, and even though all of the colors are similar, everything is distinct. And this is another good example of that, titled Marguerite. So Marguerite is, we believe, was her maid when she lived in France. That's what we think. But again, it doesn't matter. For a lot of portraiture, somebody pays somebody to have their portrait drawn. And of course, you know who they are because they paid for it. Not so with these types. We think we know who Marguerite was. We don't even know if that was her real name. But again, the point is not who the person is being painted here. The point is the interplay between light and fabric and color. Specifically here, I've always been fascinated seeing this, especially in person. Really, the image here doesn't quite do it justice. But I've always been fascinated with kind of this quadrant of the painting and how Watkins was really able to paint the shadow of the wall, but you can still see the wall and you can still see this very thin lacy dress. And it's just the ability to make all of those things distinct, all of those pieces of the painting distinct, is just, a talent. So, as I mentioned before, she got sick and she agrees to marry Goldsborough Sapel. Of course, they don't mention any of that drama in the wedding announcement. They just say, Miss Watkins is going to marry Goldsborough Sapel. They don't say that he asked her 7 times, and they don't say that she has tuberculosis. They don't say any of that. And of course, why would they? But this is the announcement, right? So, of course, they get married, and a few months later, she dies, unfortunately. And I believe that if she had lived another 30 years, that she would be a much larger figure in art history, especially in American art history, on par with Mary Cassatt. I think that she was headed that way. William Merritt Chase, contemporary of both Cassatt and Watkins, really appreciated Watkins' talent. And upon her death, he spoke at her funeral. And he also painted this full body portrait of Susan Watkins. So this is Susan Watkins painted by William Merritt Chase. And you can tell just by the grandeur of this portrait that William Merritt Chase respected Susan Watkins. She is seated here with her paint brushes back here, and she has a completed painting here, and she has one that's kind of in progress, and she has a study for the painting right here. And yet she is poised, and she is elegant, and her hair is up, and she's wearing a beautiful gown. And so this is a portrait done by William Merritt Chase of a woman that he highly respected as an artist and as a person. He did this for himself. This was not for Goldsboro Sapel. Nobody asked him to do this. He did this for her memory. So I kind of brought it to that crescendo because I wanted to bring us back down to earth, because she's buried in Elmwood at the Sapel family lot. And after all I've told you, and they knew all this, she's buried in Elmwood, and this is her tombstone. Wife of Goldsboro Sapel. She'd been married to him like 6 months. So, you know, I never thought that was right, but, you know, no one asked me. So Susan Watkins, one of the big artists buried in Elmwood, and all of the paintings that I just mentioned for Susan Watkins are owned by the Chrysler, and many of them are on display currently. So the next artist that we're going to talk about is William Cooper. He was, of course, the artist for the Cooper Angel that we saw at the beginning. So he was a renowned sculptor that studied he went to Juilliard, then he went to the Royal Academy of Surgery, where he studied anatomy. Then he went on the Grand Tour of Europe. He toured Europe for 8 years. And studying all of the old masters. His father really paved the way for him, founding Cooper Marble Works in Norfolk. This was a business that was open, I believe, 125 years. It was open 1850s through 1970s. William Cooper has a lot of credits, not only in the city, but nationwide. The old Johnny Rebel atop the Confederate Memorial was done by William Cooper. The statue of John Smith at Jamestown, many others. There are several busts that William Cooper did for the U.S. Naval Memorial in D.C., as well as there are several statues on the Stanford University campus, as well as the Stanford Family Mausoleum, etc. I could keep going. So I'm going to focus on some of the works that are in the city. So this is a bust titled marble bust titled Evangeline, again, owned by the Chrysler Museum of Art. And of course, we have the Cooper Angel and a bust of Robert Edwin Peary, although I would retitle this one to Robert Edwin Peary's Mustache. That's what I would call it, personally. So in his spare time, William Cooper was not only a renowned sculptor, but also an architect on the side, right? Must be nice. And during his spare time, he designed this very darling little neo-Gothic mausoleum that we saw in that earlier picture from 100 years ago, the black and white one. So, which is a good segue into this section on some of the architecture in Elmwood. So neoclassical really just means imitating the classics, new classics. Same with neo-Gothic. Really, anything neo just means it ain't new, even though neo means new. Typically, the architecture, at least the examples in Elmwood, imposing stone structures, bold, and resembling temples, churches, and the like. So we'll start with our most recent example, the Lekeys Mausoleum, which, as I said, is just the most darling little Gothic chapel that I've ever seen. This was made to look just like that, to look like a small chapel. In fact, if you walk inside, it looks very much like a chapel. There is a small altar straight ahead. And on the back end, parallel to the door, which you can't see here, is stained glass. So right behind this little altar, there is stained glass. So it is a place that if the family wanted to, they could go in and have a moment. So when we talk about Gothic or neo-Gothic architecture, there's really a few telltale details, architectural details, that if you want to look for it, it might help you identify things. The big one with Gothic architecture is the pointed archway, or that's one of them. For millennia, the archway was curved. And they realized that if they just put a little point in it, that the stress line would be raised, which means the height of the archway in general could be raised, which means they could have larger windows and they could have larger doors and larger entryways, and they could fill those windows with fantastical things like stained glass. So that coupled with the ribbed ceilings, which are essentially indoor columns that kind of split off to support a large ceiling that look like, you know, ribs coming off of it, as well as flying buttresses on the outside, which we don't have those here. But all of those things come together to create these grand Gothic cathedrals of medieval Europe that we're used to. It basically allowed masons to build bigger and larger and to have churches that weren't supported just by walls, and large openings that could still be supported with just glass. And so it was really these technological innovations that made Gothic cathedrals distinct. And so this is just a miniature neo version of one of the large Gothic cathedrals. Oh, and I included that earlier picture. How smart am I? Current Josh. Thanks, Past Josh, for including that. So we have the Laches Mausoleum, and we will move on to the Core Mausoleum. So, of course, we talked about love and faith and hope and charity, but I wanted to talk a little bit about the mausoleum itself. Before that, I want to talk a little bit about Jonathan Core, who was a large landowner in Norfolk. He owned most of Ghent, what is today Ghent. And when he died, another good find, this was the advertisement for the auction of his lands. And if we zoom in on the bottom, you can see this is Ghent right here. Collie Avenue is right here. This is 21st Street. So this is 21st and Collie, if anybody's familiar right here. So this is basically all of West Ghent, and part of Hampton Boulevard would go right through the middle. So this is just a plot of farmland that his estate was selling off. But the reason I mention this is because he dies and he has lots of money. So the Core Mausoleum is the largest and most expensive structure in Elmwood. Does anyone want to take a guess how much? Ah, never mind. You guessed right. Cost $100,000, right? Which is several million today. He spent a lot of money on this this mausoleum, which features these classical features, Doric columns, flat pavement. There's also a nice portico, and just for a little comparing and contrasting, just so that you can see some similarities. Jonathan Core, just a little clarification, he died in 1911, and then he was buried on the Eastern Shore, which is where his family was from. And he didn't actually build this until 1915, when his wife died, and then they could both be interred in there. So he was disinterred from the Eastern Shore and brought here once his wife died and once this was built. Because I knew you were all just wondering. after all that, he had a wife for like 42 years, and he builds this big monument, and he puts his name over the door, which I thought was telling. So he didn't put Core, he didn't put him and his wife's names, just his name. So moving on, this features a 40-foot dome interior with a very nice echo, if you ever get a chance to go in. And within the mausoleum, we have what at one point was a skylight, but has since been plugged up. And just comparing some of the features inside, of course, hand-laid stone mosaics of Elmwood with some of the ancient Roman mosaics of the past. So with each of these, they feature ivy, as you can see, which is this ancient symbol of fidelity and honesty and steadfastness and eternity. It really means, actually, it means whatever you want it to mean. If you look up all of the possibilities for ivy, it can mean just about everything. Most of them are positive. And in fact, in Elmwood, there are hundreds of bushels of ivy that have been planted over people's graves, so it's quite fitting that there's a tribute here. So if anybody has driven by Elmwood Cemetery, you will see the core mausoleum is very close to Princess Anne Road, and there is a lot of, it's very visible. So I just want to talk for a moment about, you know, what we've talked about. Elmwood, as I've always seen it, it's a lot of things. It's a recreational space. Of course, first and foremost, it's a burial ground, but it's also a museum. It's a museum without walls and without ceiling, in my opinion. So you have many unique works. A lot of the most unique, in my opinion, are from the time it was founded, 1853, until the 1920s or so. And of course, with that, many artists that we did not have time to really talk about. I spoke about the three that's, in my opinion, were the largest, most successful, had the largest collection of art and the most information about them out there. But there were some really talented silversmiths that are buried in Elmwood, and some really talented kind of artisan furniture and cabinetry makers. And it could be argued that they were artists themselves. And of course, the architecture that that we've just recently seen. So I wanted to mention, as I did before, that even though I own Norfolk Tour Company, Norfolk Tour Company does not give tours of Elmwood Cemetery. It's just I personally used to give them years ago. So the organization that takes care of those is Norfolk Society for Cemetery Conservation. They have dozens of tours a year of Elmwood, Cedar Grove, Forest Lawn. Shannon Stafford is one of their tour guides. There are others, but their names escape me at this time. NSCCVA.org is their website where you can find out more about their tours. They're free, but there's a $5 suggested donation. And you can also find more information on their Facebook page. So during my day job is I run Norfolk Tour Company, where a lot of the skill sets that I put together for the tours of Elmwood, I now put together for other tours. So we've developed 21 walking tours, not just of Norfolk, Virginia Beach, and Suffolk, and it ranges everything from let's see here. Perfect. So from public art, the Neon District, the Vibe District, to historic neighborhoods, Ghent, the Freemason neighborhood, historic churches in Ghent and downtown. We also give tours for the Elizabeth River Trail. Although we don't give tours of any cemeteries in Norfolk, we do give tours of the historic Cedar Hill Cemetery in Suffolk, and our first one is this Saturday. If anybody's been, if you haven't been to Cedar Hill, it's beautiful. It's early 19th century cemetery on a big rolling hill. So it's very pretty. So if anybody has any questions about tours or about anything, you can email me at that number. Well, thank you all for coming. I appreciate it. I'm going to hand it over to Peggy. Thank you, Peggy. You want to step here?